other microphone turned on here. All right. Good morning. Good to see everybody here today. I did fail to mention one thing that I meant to say. Yesterday, Joseph and Cassidy got engaged. So next time you see them, guess it'll be Wednesday night or Sunday morning, next Sunday. Be sure to congratulate them on their engagement. That's a big moment for both of them, big change coming in their life, but it's a good one. And we want to congratulate them in that effort. I invite you to turn your Bibles to John chapter 8. John chapter 8 is where I want to begin today. We're going to be taking, the main thoughts are going to be taken from John chapter, or excuse me, 2 John, verses 1 through 4. But I want to begin by stating something, or elaborating on something, I should say, from what Jesus says in John chapter 8. In John chapter 8, verse 32, or if you'll go to verse 31, begin in verse 31 with me. It says, Jesus said to the Jews who had believed him, "If you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." They answered him, "We are offspring of Abraham and have never been enslaved to anyone. How is it that you say you will become free?" And so Jesus says here in verse 32 that you will know the truth and the truth will set you free. How would you expect these people to respond to Jesus based on what we read in verse 31? Verse 31 says, Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him. And so for these Jews to have believed in Jesus, we might expect him to respond very positively with what he says about truth. You will know the truth, and the truth will set you free, Jesus says. Well, since they believe in Jesus, we expect them to respond in the way that they should as disciples of Jesus. But that's not what we find, is it? In verse 33, they answered him, "We are offspring of Abraham and have never been enslaved to anyone. How is it that you say you will become free?" Here we have Jesus speaking to a group of people that claim to believe in him, that John tells us have believed in him. But they don't believe that they are enslaved to anything. They don't believe that the truth is going to set them free from anything because they don't believe that they are enslaved. We live in a world today that's very similar to this type of attitude. We live in a world today that do not see the importance, that does not see the importance of truth. There are people that believe, well, if I want to divorce my wife and go marry somebody else, then I have the right to do that. I have the right to do that because that's what I want to do. If I want to change my figure, even though I've been a woman for 33 years, I decide I want to be a man. Hey, I can do that because that's what I want to do. Truth is what I want it to be. It doesn't matter what the Bible says. Truth is what I want it to be. And that's the world that we live in today. But it goes even further than that. It's not just that people want the truth that they desire. Even religiously speaking, people do not see the significance of truth today. People bounce around from church after church after church looking for what they want. And that's why they church hop, because they find something that's different from what they want. And so they go to another church. They go to a church that forms to their teaching or their ideology, and it even happens, I'm sure you've noticed this like I have, it even happens that people go around to all of these different churches, they search denomination after denomination, they don't find one that they like, and so what do? Well, I'll just go start my own. And that's what many people do. They start their own church, create some followers, put a name on the building that has nothing to do with Scripture, and voila, you have another church that is not based on truth, it's based on what somebody else wanted to be true. Have you ever wondered, like I have, when I ride down the road, I see all these different names on signs of church buildings, and I'm thinking, where in the world did they get that name? That doesn't make any sense. And why does it not make sense? It doesn't make sense to us because we don't find the name in the New Testament. If I find the name in the New Testament, let's say I have no idea what truth is. I have no idea what the church is supposed to be. But I find a church that has a name that I find in the New Testament, I might at least think, hey, they're trying to do what's right because the name attached to it is something that I find in the New Testament. It may or may not be true. I've mentioned this before and I'll mention it again. I think this is important. Just because our name on the sign in the front yard says Church of Christ does not make us right. You can have a good name but not practice what is right. But why do we find all of those different names and names that have nothing to do with the New Testament, have nothing to do with doctrinal truth? It's because people choose what is right for themselves rather than letting God choose what is right. It's the world that we live in today. But here's the fact of the matter. The word truth is one of the most important words that we read in the Bible. It's very important. And the reason it's so important is because it identifies what is right, not based on what I want, but it's based on what God wants. If it's true, it must be true according to God's standards, not according to my standards. And so when we look at truth in the Bible, we learn about that. We read about that. I read that truth is what God says it is, not what I want it to be, but what God wants it to be. And that's why it's such an important word that we find in the Bible, because God deems what is true and what is not. The word truth in the New Testament alone, I did not calculate how many times we find true in the Old Testament, but in the New Testament alone, the Greek word that translates truth is found over 100 times. It's a very important theme in the New Testament. And not all 100 times does it refer to doctrinal truth, but it shows us that truth is very important to God. It's very important to His church. It's very important to the things that we are trying to carry out as we try to live in the church that God has established. There's a right and a wrong way to do things. We go to 2 John verses 1 through 4. And in these four verses, we find the word truth five times. Now, we don't find the word truth anymore in this book, and that might not surprise us because it's only 13 verses, but the idea is stamped out in the five uses of the word in the first four verses, but then we find that theme carried all throughout the remainder of this letter. Look at verse 6. This is love, that we walk according to His commandments. You want to take according to His commandments away and put their truth, you would not be doing any damage to the text. Because according to God's commandments, according to Christ's commandments, that is truth. And so we find the theme here. This is the commandment, just as you have heard from the beginning, so that you should walk in it. Verse 7, for many deceivers have gone out into the world. Those who do not confess the coming of Jesus Christ in the flesh, such a one is the deceiver and the antichrist. So here you have a group of people. John proclaims them to be deceivers, because they're not adhering to the standard or the certain teaching that we find throughout the New Testament that must be adhered to. For example, in 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 13, Paul wrote to Timothy saying, "Hold fast to the pattern or the form of sound words." Sound there does not mean it's solid. Sound there means healthy. Healthy words, healthy teaching. We'll find it all over the place in the pastoral epistles, 1 and 2 Timothy and Titus, that being. Sound words, sound teaching is everywhere. But Paul wants Timothy to hold fast to the pattern or the form of those sound words. Romans chapter 6 and verse 17, Paul said, "You obeyed from the heart that form or that standard of teaching to which you were committed." What's the standard of teaching that he is talking about? He's talking about baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins. reenacting that death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And that's what makes a person a slave of God. And they must continue in that slavery. You're not slave to sin anymore. Now you're slaves of God because you have obeyed that form or that pattern, that standard of teaching. The deceivers have not held fast to that. And so what is wrong? It's not truth. It's false. And so what does John write next? He says, verse 9, everyone who goes on ahead and does not abide in the teaching of Christ, in other words, does not abide in this truth, he does not have God. But everyone who abides in the teaching has both the Father and the Son. So all throughout this letter, even though it's 13 verses, it reeks of what truth must be to believers. But what about the components of truth that I have prefaced for you here on the screen? As I mentioned, 5 times the word truth is used in the first 4 verses. It identifies some standard components of what doctrinal truth is all about that we must adhere to. And I want us to look very briefly at these standard components of truth. First of all, you've got the fellowship of truth. Look at verse 1. John says, "The elder to the elect lady and her children, whom I love in truth, and not only I, but also all who know the truth." You have fellowship here involved with believers. What is their fellowship in? It is in truth because they are all part of this same truth with one another. And so what does truth do? Truth helps us identify what we share with one another. But truth doesn't only identify our fellowship or what we share with one another, but as by association, if truth allows us to share things with one another, have fellowship with one another in that truth, then guess what truth also does? It also identifies the boundaries of fellowship. If you look at verses 10 and 11, this is something that John underscores. He says, "If anyone comes to you and does not bring this teaching, do not receive him into your house or give him any greeting, for whoever greets him takes part in his wicked works." John says, if you got somebody that doesn't believe in the true teaching of Scripture, about Jesus, about this truth, if they are a deceiver, don't receive them into your house. Don't fellowship with them. As a matter of fact, get them away. Don't have anything to do with them. Because truth doesn't just show us, hey, we share with something. That's great. That's right. We are a collective body. We do all these things together. Yes, it does that. But also by association, it says what we do not need to be fellowshipping with. There's boundaries associated with the fellowship as well. When you scale the New Testament and the Bible as a whole, one of the biggest problems that people face is, where do I draw the line at fellowship? There are problems that we find between relationships all over the place. For example, the biggest one perhaps is between Jews and Gentiles. When we get into the New Testament, we find problems between Jesus and the Pharisees. We've also find problems between Jews and Sadducees. We find problems between Jews and Samaritans. So you've got this divide. You've got this disconnect all over the place in Scripture. Well, how do we build those relationships back to where they need to be? How can I take Jews and Gentiles and bring them together? How can I take Jesus and the Pharisees and bring them together? So on and so forth. How do I do that? May I suggest to you that the best way for us to make fellowship with other people is to have the truth. Truth is the best way to do it. Because not only does it tell us this is where we find fellowship, but it underscores the boundaries of fellowship. So what do? I find the truth of the matter. And I bring everyone together based on what truth is. Because let's face it, If I believe one thing and you believe another, if I say, well, hey, I think this is true, you say, hey, I think this is true, are we going to be able to find a whole lot of fellowship with one another? Let's say we all come to church one Sunday morning. This side of the auditorium says, you know what? We need to take the Lord's Supper every single first day of the week. That's the way we need to do things. That is truth. This side over here says, you know what? I don't see that as a very important issue. I don't see that as being a truth or false matter. Are we going to be able to have fellowship with each other? What's going to happen is one of us is going to leave and go somewhere else. Because you can't have fellowship without truth. We can't believe all different things and expect to be able to find unity in Christ. It doesn't work that way. The religious world that we live in has been trying to do that ever since the foundation of denominationalism. And where are we? Where has it gotten us? Just about every day, some new church pops up, some new belief pops up. Because truth underscores the boundaries of fellowship. But what's the best way to do it? What's the best way to find unity? The best way to do it is with truth. I want to share with you one example where this actually happens. Turn your Bibles to Acts chapter 10. Acts chapter 10, this is where Peter and Cornelius have their encounter. You remember what Peter is doing? Peter is up on top of the roof of Simon the Tanner's house. He's about to eat lunch, and he's praying, probably for his lunch. And what he does is he sees this vision. God lowers down this thing. Your translation may say sheet, but really it's just a thing. We don't know what it is. But it's lowered down. It's got all of these animals on it, animals that are both clean and unclean. God says, get up, Peter, kill and eat. Peter says, what? No, I'm not going to. He doesn't do that because he knows what truth is. All his life he has been taught from Scripture, from the Old Testament, that you make that distinction between there are animals that are clean, there are animals that are unclean. So Peter says, no, I don't want any part of it. I'm not doing it. God gives him that vision three times before he finally gets it and says, okay, I'll do it. Then you've got Cornelius, some messengers from Cornelius' household. They come to get Peter. They get him, they bring him to Cornelius' house, and somewhere along the way, Peter began to realize that this is not about what I eat. This is about fellowship between Jews and Gentiles. Because look at what it says in verse 28. It says, he said to them, you yourselves know how unlawful it is for a Jew to associate with or to visit anyone of another nation. But God has shown me that I should not call any person common or unclean. Wait a minute, Peter. All you saw was some clean and unclean animals coming down out of heaven on a sheet or a thing. God showed that to you. Well, somewhere along the line, Peter has either been given further revelation or has figured things out. But this is not about animals. This is about people. And so Cornelius' house and his friends have gathered and they say, we are here to hear what you have to say. Have you ever been put on the spot? Said, all right, time for you to preach. That's happened to me a couple of times. I don't like it very much. But that's what Peter has been called to do. He has a message that has obviously been given to him by God to preach to these people. What is that message? Verses 34 and 35. So Peter opened his mouth and said, truly, I understand. There's our word, right? One of the 100 times in the New Testament. Truly, in adverb form. Truly. I understand, that God shows no partiality. But in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. Your translation may say works righteousness. That would be a more literal translation. But what do you have here? Peter is learning that anybody that does what is right is able to be accepted by God and enter into that family. But they have to do what is right, correct? They can't just do whatever they want to. How do Jews and Gentiles find fellowship with one another? They find it based on the truth. How do we find fellowship with one another? We find it based on the truth. Because one of the components of truth in 2 John chapter 1, or excuse me, 2 John verse 1, and other passages of Scripture as well, is fellowship. Next, you've got the duration of truth. So we continue reading, you look at verse 2, 2 John verse 2, because of the truth that abides in us and will be with us forever. How long is it going to be with us? A couple of weeks, 6 months or so. When I'm dried from my baptism, is that when truth goes away? No, John says it lasts forever. I don't like math. I'll underscore it this way. I hate math. I don't want anything to do with it. I hate math. But I don't have to be a mathematician to know what forever means. Forever means that it's never going to die. It's never going to pass away. It's going to be that way forever. It is set in stone. A couple of weeks ago, I took a test at school, and I had one of our teachers threw us a softball. It was like one of those questions that wasn't right or wrong, but it was one of the most difficult questions to answer because he said, define what eternity means. And I'm thinking, how much time do I have? How many pages do I have? How do you define eternity? You can't do it. We can't really put it in our own words, but we understand the meaning, don't we? We understand the concept that as far back as you want to go, and as far forward as you want to go, and even beyond how far you want to go, because that's what eternity is. I can't understand it. My mind is finite. I can only understand things so far. But when it comes to God being eternal, He has no boundaries. He has no limits. He is boundless. And so that's basically what God's truth is all about. Scripture has a time where in its written form it began, but really it had no beginning because it existed in the mind of God for all eternity. And so it's there forever. Never fades away, never goes away. So just as 1 + 1 = 2, 2 + 2 = 4, Scripture equals forever. It never fades away. It lasts forever. Psalm 119, turn there with me real quickly. Psalm 119, we're going to look at verse 160. Psalm 119, verse 160. I love this psalm. This psalm is all about God and His Word. Those are the two main themes of Psalm 119, God and His Word. Psalm 119, 160 says this, the sum of your word is truth, and every one of your righteous rules endures forever. There are a couple of ways that this has been interpreted, meaning the sum of your word is truth, the way the ESV translates it. If that's what the psalmist means here, he means take all of God's word, take every bit of what you read in Scripture, put it together, and it equals truth. I'm not so sure that's what the psalmist is saying. I don't think that's the best interpretation. What I think the psalmist is saying here is that look at God's word and what do you find? It's always standardized. That's always going to be the way that it is. It is eternal. It never fades away. It lasts forever. I think that's what the psalmist is trying to say because that's what he says at the very last line. Your righteous rules endure forever. Where does he find peace and comfort, or why does he find peace and comfort in Scripture? What's the circumstances leading to him thinking about this? Well, there are many different circumstances we can point out. But look at verse 155. Salvation is far from the wicked, for they do not seek your statutes. Verse 157, many are my persecutors and my adversaries, but I do not swerve from your testimonies. Verse 158, I look at the faithless with disgust because they do not keep your commandments. The psalmist is receiving opposition from all over the place, people that are wicked, people that don't adhere to Scripture's teaching. Where does he find comfort? Where does he find his peace and his joy? He finds it from God's word because the adversaries that he is facing are temporary. They do not last forever, but what does? the word that he finds comfort in, that does last forever. I want to read one more passage and then we'll move on. Hebrews chapter 13. I want to read this because a lot of times we look at verse 8. Most of us can quote Hebrews chapter 13 and verse 8, but we oftentimes look at it by itself, and I don't think it needs to be looked at that way. Hebrews 13 and verse 8 says, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. Amen. Does our Savior change? Is He ever going to be different? No, He's not. But let's not detach this verse from its context. What's being talked about? Look at verse 9. Do not be led away by diverse and strange teachings. There is right and wrong. There is truth and there is false. Where do we find the truth? We find it in Jesus Christ. Does that truth change? No, it does not, because we find that truth in our Savior that doesn't change. See, what's going on in the book of Hebrews is the writer's writing to a group of people that are trying to go back to Judaism. They're trying to go back to keeping the old law for salvation. And the whole premise of the book of Hebrews is that the law has been done away with. The Old Testament law has been done away with. Jesus has issued in a new law. The old law has been rendered obsolete. So don't go back to the old law, because the new law has been issued in. And that new law under Jesus Christ does not change. It lasts forever. On the day of judgment, I don't have to worry about God saying, oh, you've been taking the Lord's Supper every single Sunday? Didn't you get the memo? That's past. That ship has sailed. We don't do that anymore. Do we have to worry about that? Does God's word ever change? Does it ever go away? No, it doesn't. It lasts forever. One of the components of truth is to know that every time I open the Bible and I read it and I study it and I learn something about who I'm supposed to be, when I learn that information, I can devote my entire life to that information, because I know that it's never going to change. Number three, we've got the origin of truth. Verse 3 says this, grace, mercy, and peace will be with us from God the Father and from Jesus Christ, the Father's Son, in truth and love. Where is it coming from? It's coming from God the Father, from our Lord Jesus Christ. The origin of truth is rock solid in deity. Deity in its richest form. Deity in our Father. Deity in our Savior. That's where it comes from. As we mentioned earlier, it doesn't have a beginning initially. In its written form, it does. There was a time when Moses sat down and began writing the first book that we have in Scripture, the book of Genesis. But that truth has existed in the mind of God ever since. Well, that's really not a good way to put it either, is it? It's always eternally existed in the mind of God. It is eternal truth. It's the origin of truth. 2 Samuel chapter 7. We'll read this and then we'll move on. We were reading, actually, 2 Samuel chapter 7 was part of our reading last night as a family. We read two chapters every night before we go to bed. And this was part of the reading that we had last night. And I chose to use this before we ever read it last night. But what's going on in 2 Samuel 7 is David wants to build God a house. God doesn't have a house to dwell in. He's been in a tabernacle that you pick up and move everywhere. And God wants him to have a permanent place of residence in the city of Jerusalem. But God says, David, don't you think if I wanted that, I would have already told somebody to build it for me? I haven't told anybody to build it for me because the way that I want things to be is not formed yet. But I tell you what I'm going to do. I am going to have a house built for me. You're not going to be the one to build it. Your son Solomon is going to be the one to build it. Your dynasty, your name is going to sit on the throne forever. Yes, your son is going to build a house for me. But when it comes to you and your name, I'm going to build you a house, a dynasty that does not fade away. It lasts forever. What if God came to me and said, Mitchell, I'm going to make an entire dynasty out of you. It's going to last forever. It's never going to fade away. Chew on that for a while. How would you respond to that? God telling you that. I would be, God, all I wanted to do was build you a house. You're overwhelming me with this information. All I wanted to do was build you a permanent place of residence that we could, you could always be part of and not have to worry about this tabernacle anymore. That's all I wanted. But God says, I'm going to build you a house. It's going to last forever. How does David respond? Verse 28. Now, O Lord God, you are God, and your words are true. You have promised this good thing to your servant. Now, therefore, may it please you to bless the house of your servant so that it may continue forever before you. For you, O Lord God, have spoken, and with your blessing shall the house of your servant be blessed forever. Going back to what we just talked about with the duration of truth, have you ever wondered, how has the church been able to stand, been able to last for so long? Century after century after century, people have been trying to discredit it, have been trying to speak out against it, yet here it is. It still remains. We could say the same thing about the Bible. The most scrutinized book in the history of books is the Bible. Every single day, books, articles, speeches are given trying to discredit the Bible. Yet it still remains. Yet it still remains the best-selling book and always will be the most printed and best-selling book. Why? Because its duration is forever, and its origin is based on the eternal God that we serve. So how do we bring this thing to a close? We live it out. The lifestyle of truth is basically what the remainder of 2 John is about. The fourth component is the lifestyle of truth. Verse 4 says, I rejoice greatly to find some of your children walking in the truth, just as we were commanded by the Father. The way that this word walking is used in this context, it has to do with life, with practice. What do? We live it out. We practice it. It's not enough just to know the Bible. It's not enough just to quote the Bible. It's not enough just to tote the Bible. I need to do all of those things. But along with doing those things, I have to show the Bible. I have to disclose the Bible to the people that I come in contact with. I can walk around all day long holding this Bible, shaking it all I want, but if my life does not adhere to the teaching that I find in Scripture, it doesn't matter what I know. There is a lifestyle that is involved in the truth of Scripture as well. Don't just know it. We have to show it. It's essential that we do both of those things. I want to close by reading 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 2. 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 2. Paul has been dealing with false teachers, trying to discredit him as a true apostle, and that's the context mainly of the book of 2 Corinthians. Paul's trying to bolster himself as a true apostle, give the evidence to back up his apostleship and discredit those that are not true apostles. Well, one of the things that he uses to show the proof of his discipleship is the way that he does not have to hide his message. Paul can live out his message openly and plainly to everyone and not be ashamed of any of it because he's a true apostle. But what about those that are not true apostles? He says in verse 2, but we have renounced disgraceful or shameful, underhanded or hidden ways. We refuse to practice cunning or deception or to tamper or change God's word. But by the open statement of the truth, we would commend ourselves to everyone's conscience in the sight of God. If it's true, I don't have to change a thing. If it's true, I don't have to be ashamed of anything. If it's true, I don't have to hide anything. If it's true, I can live my life openly in the sight of everyone that is involved because I know that the things that I am doing are right. And again, they are not right because I say they're right. They're right because they are rooted and grounded in Scripture. The opponents of Paul that he is addressing or that he is battling, spiritually speaking, in the book of 2 Corinthians, are doing all of those things. They're ashamed, so they live their life, or they couch their message in a certain way to make it attractive, to make people believe in them. Why are they doing that? Because it's not the truth. It doesn't measure up to what the Bible teaches. When it comes to truth, it's more than just knowing what is right. With all these four components, it's about the fellowship of truth. How long is that relationship going to last? Where did that relationship come from to begin with? And how am I going to live my life? And I need to go ahead and click the slide. But how am I going to live my life? All of those things are involved in the subject of doctrinal truth. Again, I said, aletheia is mentioned 100 times in the New Testament. Not all 100 times is it mentioned as being doctrinal truth, but the standard of measurement remains the same. The question is, are we adhering to the doctrine of truth? Are we ensuring that everything we are doing in life is based on what I read in this book? I understand there are some ambiguities and there are some questions that we have because we don't know everything. If we did know everything, all of the answers to all of the questions that we have, I couldn't tote the Bible behind my truck because it would be too big, too heavy, too cumbersome to be able to deal with. But what I have in this book are principles that teach me how to adhere to the truth that God has given me in this book. My job as a Christian is to adhere to those principles as best I can, to forget about what I want, and to think about what God wants, and mold and shape my life on that teaching. If you're here tonight, here this morning, and you need help doing that, the opportunity is available for you to respond to the invitation and ask for prayers and comfort, guidance, strength, whatever you need. It's not always easy to adhere to the truth. Sometimes there is pull and push from all kinds of different directions. But there is no greater pull, no stronger pull than the one coming from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. He wants us to do what is right because He knows that what we find in Scripture is right. You need help doing that this morning. There may be someone here that wants to learn more about the church, learn more about salvation, and they have questions. Ask those questions today. Let's respond to the invitation if we need to as we stand and sing.